Today, we're going to talk about something related to the so-called the beginner's mind. So let's begin with an experience that most of us have gone through. We read a book long, long time ago, and then we gained some understanding of the book. Later on, because of some reasons, we had to reread the book. And surprisingly, the book sounds very new to us, as if it were not the same book we have known previously. Remaining intact, the book is not rewritten by any means, but as the reading subject, we have changed. Now we rereading the book with a new mindset built upon our accumulated living experiences, differing from those of 5 or 10 years ago. So this is a story related to the mind in general, and to some extent, it is relevant to the beginner's mind in particular. So, what is the beginner mind? What kind of role it can play in our extremely busy life? And how can we retrieve and cultivate it? So, the beginner's mind is a Zen concept employed as the backbone of Suzuki Shunryu's book called Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind. First published in 1970, the book has 2 calligraphies by the Zen master. Here they are. The first calligraphy is printed on the front cover of the book, and that is Nyurai in Japanese or Nyurai in Vietnamese. And that is the translation of the Sanskrit Tathagata. Tathagata in its turn is the Buddha's other name. And what it means? It means the one who has thus come or gone. So pay attention to the term thus. The term thus in this case means thatness or suchness, or that the way things are. Tathagata is also represent the Zen mind that can see things as they are, that can see the diversity of things as they are, and gradually recognize the original nature of all things. So the Zen master Suzuki used a leaf of a yucca plant as his brush, and he wrote these 2 characters, implying that Tathagata is the body of the whole world or whole earth. The second calligraphy is printed inside the book, which denotes a Japanese expression called Shoshin or Sertam in Vietnamese, which means the beginner's mind, and in its turn, this term requires further explanation. So I read the Suzuki book about 15 years ago, and now I have the chance to reread it lately in connection with the Dead Child topic today. And it didn't take me long to recognize the newness of the own book. So in the prologue, the author warned us about the risk of losing our original attitudes towards routine practices. Let's talk about the book reading experience. So our new knowledge, our new experience, our new approaches can help us to view a previously read book in a new light. But be careful, because our experience, our knowledge, and our approaches can easily turn into obstacles to our learning process. In order to stay open-minded and open to any possibilities, we should retrieve our beginner's mind and set aside all of the prejudices, all of our familiarities, all of our preconceptions. Okay? And by doing so, we are attaining the soul calm, the beginner's mind. And the beginner's mind here comes up as a original mind, open to potentials. Rereading the book this time, I'm amazed by its warning of against the distinction between the subject and the object. While the original mind stayed open and ready to take into consideration of any opportunities open to a wide variety of options, the self-centered mind would stay firm on the distinction between me and the other. In that case, this distinction somehow limits us, somehow preventing us from seeing things, from seeing new perspectives and new possibilities. Therefore, we should be careful with what we have known, and then when we learn something new, try to set aside what we have learned, try to unlearn what we have learned, and let your mind empty and let your mind free to receive new knowledge, new experience. Obviously, the beginner's mind can help us to be a better learner, right? And in terms of a teacher, I also think that the beginner's mind also put a teacher in a position of an open-minded learner who is willing to conduct constructive conversations with his students, listening to his students' suggestions, opinions, and comments in order to help them to learn better. On the one hand, and on the other hand, improve himself as a fully developed intellectual. So, now we live not alone. We do not live alone as isolated authors. No, but we live together as community and society, in which communication would play a key role, in relationship building, right? So we can do that with the sơ tâm, right? Sơ tâm. And the term tâm in sơ tâm should be understood as not only the mind, but this is the heart and mind. The heart and mind. So the beginner's heart and mind encourages us to enter any conversation with open-mindedness and empathy, right? And it also helps us to build up and strengthen our relationships. I think that we all have experienced this. We, when involved in dialogues with others, we often only hear but not truly listen to the interlocutor. Why? Because we are busy talking to ourselves with presumptions and preconceptions in our mind. Now, if you have the so-called beginner's heart and mind, you can actively engage in conversation with others with an open heart of empathy, an open mind of understanding. Let's take a kind of analogy. Like a traveler who will leave his dirty and mucky shoes at the doorstep before entering a host house, we should leave our prejudgments, our preconceptions out prior to entering any kind of conversation with others. Listening carefully with the heart and mind of the beginner, we can help to bring up the comprehensively understand of the others. Even though in a conversation, if only one party practiced the so-called the beginner's heart and mind, even in that kind of situation, it can also encourage the other to do the same. Why? Because of the openness and the empathy that one party already carried out. So, now we're questioning, because nowadays we talk about the so-called critical thinking all the time, right? So we say that, well, we should practice the beginner's heart and mind. So where is the room for critical thinking? You may wonder. Well, this is a very, good question. And from my own opinion, I think that the so-called critical thinking should be with us all the time. But it will come later, after we have got some understanding of the other. The operation of the critical thinking should be accompanied by the beginner's heart and mind. Why? Because if we're doing that, we will actively create some kind of mutual understanding. And that kind of mutual understanding will lay out a solid foundation for our positive and collaborative chances to come, right? Now, I think that we can consider the beginner's heart and mind as something long lost, but still retrievable whenever, as soon as we really want it. And in order to have the beginner's heart and mind with us all the time as an integral part of our thought process, we should actively bring it back to the scene, like a Zen practitioner. Who from all of you practicing Zen meditation? Anyone? Yes? Quite a few, right? So, like a Zen practitioner, sitting cross-legged, focusing on the coming in and going out of the breath, being aware of the appearance of any kind of distracting thoughts that come to the mind, and gently let them go. Let them go. in order to refocus on the breath, we should do the same. We should do the same thing. We should bring our beginner's mind back to the scene, and we should actively, okay, observe it, okay? We should activate our beginner's heart and mind, and then we also have to observe ourselves carefully. So whenever we see some kind of emergence of prejudgment, preconceptions, we will gently, don't do it hardly, gently, okay, remove them and bring your heart, the beginner's heart and mind, back on track, right? So I think that now we have another example saying that when people serve you tea, what should you do? You have a cup, right? And you should keep your cup empty. Why? Because if your cup is empty, you can fully enjoy the freshness of the tea poured into the cup, right? Similarly, we should keep our mind empty. Empty in this case is not something negative. Empty is the precondition for us to receive new things. We, without any preconception, without any prejudgment, and our mind as an empty cup, we will nicely receive new things, and then later on, that invite your critical thinking back, and then that is the time for you to examine, okay, whether if you can accept this or that aspect of the orders. But don't let the critical thinking intervene right at the beginning. Right at the beginning, you should reserve some room for you to understand the other. So I'm gonna end our talk here with the analogy of the cup of tea. Please always keep your teacup empty in order to enjoy the freshness of the tea the order offer you. Thank you.